Got it.
So friends, in today's session, we are going to see about the diagnostic techniques. And the first diagnostic technique we are going to see is enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, or in short, it is called as ELISA. And the second test we are going to study, that is about the radioimmunoassay, or it is called as RIA. Okay, one by one we are going to see here. So the first one is enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. So in this enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, we are going to see about introduction to ELISA, then principle and procedure, materials required, then we will see types of enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, then advantages and disadvantages of ELISA, and finally, we will conclude with the application of enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. And after that, we will see radioimmunoassay. So there is an introduction we are going to see, principle and procedure, materials required, advantages and disadvantages of this radioimmunoassay, instrumentation, and then we will see the applications of radioimmunoassay. So first we will start with this enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, or ELISA. So this ELISA, it stands for the enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, which is a quantitative immunological procedure in which the antigen-antibody reaction is monitored by enzyme measurements. So what we are going to detect here, there is a detection of antigen or antibodies, and it is a quantitative immunological procedure. That means you are going to determine the quantity of the particular antigen or antibody. So the term ELISA was first time used by Engel and Perlmutter in 1971. So this ELISA test, or simply it is called as enzyme immunoassay. So it was the first screening test, which is commonly employed or used for the diagnosis of AIDS disease, that is detection of human immuno or HIV virus. Okay? Human immunodeficiency virus. And this ELISA, it is highly sensitive in nature. Highly sensitive in nature in the sense it can detect the small, even small quantity of that antigen or antibody also. Okay. So why that known as enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay? So is it visible? Screen is visible or not?
Visible, sir.
Yes.
Okay. So that antigen of interest, it is absorbed onto the plastic surface. Okay. So when you are going to detect that particular antigen in the blood of that patient, for example, so that antigen of interest or desired antigen, it is absorbed onto the plastic surface. Then that same antigen, it is recognized by the specific antibody molecule. Okay. Because that specific antibody molecule, we know that these antigen antibody reactions, these are highly specific in nature. Okay. So this antibody, it is recognized by the second antibody later on, which has the enzyme attached or linked. So that's why it is called as the enzyme linked in the name of that test here. And that substrate later on, they reacts with the enzyme, and there's a formation of colored product. So formation of this colored product, that indicates that ELISA test is positive. Okay. Then next one is here. So what is the basic principle of this ELISA or enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay? So there is a use of an enzyme to detect the binding of antigen to the antibody molecule. Okay. So this enzyme later on converts that colorless substrate, which is a chromogen, and there is a formation of the colored product. So that indicate the presence of antigen-antibody binding or that complex. And this ELISA, it can be used to detect either the presence of antigen molecule, which is foreign to our body, or it is able to detect the antibodies present in the sample or in that clinical specimen. That may be the blood, that may be the serum, or another clinical samples here. And this ELISA, which was developed in 1970, and it is now rapidly accepted throughout the world for the diagnosis of the principle of ELISA. Now the next one is here. See, this is the basic procedure of the enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. See, this is the microtidal veil we can see here, which is a container, for example, and there is a to which that antibody molecules are bound here. So these Y-shaped structure, these are called as antibodies, and there is an addition of sample solution. Sample means here that is your clinical sample, okay, which consists of the antigen present in the patient. So that antigens we are going to detect whether that patient has that particular pathogen or that antigen, and the antigen which is to be measured to the well where that antibody molecule is solidified or it get bound. So this is the well here, this one, and there is an antibody molecules are attached. So this is the antigen which is present in the sample or specimen. So that sample solution containing these antibodies, it is added in this container or in this well to which that antibody molecules are bound. So that if the specific, because these antibodies are specific to which antigen you are going to detect. So that's why, because of specificity, now this antigen molecule, it get bind to the antibody molecules. Okay. So there is an antigen, it is captured by the antibody molecule. Then you have to wash out excessive substance. If there is any excessive substance, that you have to wash out. Okay. Suppose if that blood or that sample does not have this specific antigen, so that antibody molecule will remain as it is, and there are another antigens will be there, but these are not specific to this antibody molecule. So excessive substance will be washed here. Now, after that, what is the procedure here? Then you have to add enzyme labeled second antibody molecule to the well. So this is the enzyme here. This one is the enzyme, and this is bound to the antibody molecule. So this is called as enzyme labeled secondary antibody molecule, because this is the primary antibody molecule and this is secondary antibody molecule. Okay. Now, after that, what will happen? If this antibody molecule, that is secondary antibody molecule, which is a enzyme labeled antibody molecule, it get binds to the captured antigen here. This captured antigen, it get bind, there will be binding will be there. And finally, because of when that substrate is added to this complex, when that substrate is added to this well, now this substrate, it is specific to this enzyme molecule. So what will happen after washing? If there is no binding of this, यहाँ पे अगर ये बाइंड नहीं होगा तो ये एंटीबॉडी क्या होगा, हो जाएगा एंजाइम एंटीबॉडी कॉम्प्लेक्स वॉश हो जाएगा, वो वहां से निकल जाएगा वॉशिंग के बाद. और जब आप ये सब्सट्रेट ऐड करोगे तो वहां पे सब्सट्रेट को रिएक्ट करने के लिए या फिर उससे प्रोडक्ट बनाने के लिए एंजाइम वहां पे नहीं होगा, बिकॉज दैट एंजाइम इज वॉश्ड. ओके. बट व्हेन दिस एंटीबॉडी सेकेंडरी एंटीबॉडी मॉलिक्यूल गेट बाइंड टू दिस एंटीजन, then it will remain in the well even after washing. And when you will add the substrate molecule which is specific to this enzyme molecule, then this enzyme get convert this substrate molecule into the colored compound. So appearance or formation of this colored compound, it indicates that ELISA test is positive to the desired antigen molecule. Okay, so that ELISA test is positive to the desired antigen molecule. So that presence of color indicates that test is positive. Okay, why that test is positive? Because this antigen is present in the blood, this one, to which this antibody molecule or enzyme get bound, and when you will add substrate, so that enzyme convert that substrate into colored compound. That's why the observation or presence of this colored compound, that indicates that ELISA test is positive or that person is suffering from that particular disease. That is the indication here or procedure. So what are the materials required for this ELISA test here? You will require a testing sample. Then you will require antibodies, that is primary antibody and secondary antibody, or sometimes you will require antigen. Then polystyrene microtiter plate, this one. These are the polystyrene microtiter plate to which that antibody molecules or that antigen molecules are added. Then blocking buffer, washing buffer. You will require a substrate, where you have added this substrate here, that you will require, and you will also require a enzyme. Okay, so next one is the antigen molecule. So what is this antigen molecule? It is any molecule that induces the production of antibodies when introduced in the body of that particular animal, then it is called as antigen. Simply, that antigen, it is any foreign particle. Okay, so or anything which is foreign to the immune system, for example, bacteria, viruses, or the parts of that bacteria or viruses or pollen grains, all these are the antigen, or all these are foreign to our body. These are not naturally present in our body, That's why when they are enter in our body, when these viruses, bacteria, or these pollen grains or their parts enter in our body, then we can say that all these parts, all these bacteria, they are foreign to our body because they are not our own. So that's why they are foreign to our body. And any foreign particle, that is called as the antigen. Okay, and that may be the protein molecule, that may be the carbohydrate molecule, that may be the microorganisms, that may be the allergens. Allergens, that is called as allergens, means which causes the allergy. Okay, viruses. So all these structures or components, they can act as an antigen because they are foreign to our body. And generally, in immunology or in medical field, the symbol for antigen is like this triangle. Okay. Then next point is here, antibody molecule. So what are these antibody molecules? So these antibody molecules, these are the proteins which are produced in response to antigen by the immune system, and they helps in defending the against antigen molecule or against pathogen. So antibodies ye kab taiyar hote hain hamare body mein? Hamare body mein jab koi antigen enter hota hai, tab us antigen ke khilaf or against our body, our immune system produces antibody molecule, which are simply indicated as a AB. Okay, and this is the symbol for antibody molecule, because when you will study the detailed structure of antibody molecule, so that antibody molecule, these are Y-shaped structures. Okay, and if detailed structure when you will see, it will be like this here. So this orange color, it is a variable region. That means the amino acids present in this region, these are different here or here. This is the light chain, this is the heavy chain. Okay, and this site, it is called as the antigen binding site. As the name suggests here, this is the site present on antibody molecule to which that antigen get bind. Yahan pe jo humne dekha is diagram mein, see, to yahan pe kya ho gaya, ye antigen yahan pe bind ho gaya. To is site ko hum kya bolenge, antigen binding site bolenge. Okay, so that is called as the antigen binding site. And ye blue color jo region hai, ye constant region hai. It means yahan pe jo bhi amino acids present hai, ye कभी भी बदलते नहीं, ये कांस्टेंट रहते हैं. लेकिन ये ऑरेंज वाले यहाँ पे अमीनो एसिड वहाँ पे चेंज होता है और इसलिए. हाँ, यस,
सॉरी टू इंटरप्ट, कैन यू प्लीज कंटिन्यू ओनली इन इंग्लिश?
ओके ओके ओके. सो बिकॉज़ देयर आर सम स्टूडेंट्स, दे डिमांड हिंदी आल्सो, दैट्स व्हाई आई वाज टॉकिंग इन हिंदी. ओके, आई विल ट्राई 100%. ओके, सो नाउ द नेक्स्ट पॉइंट इज हियर, एंटीबॉडीज. सो सो दीज आर ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज द इम्यूनोग्लोबुलिंस. ओके, and there are five different types of antibodies or these immunoglobulins are there. One is IgG, that is immunoglobulin G, immunoglobulin A, immunoglobulin M, immunoglobulin D, and immunoglobulin E. Okay, and these are the structures of these immunoglobulins or antibodies. So this is the IgG, this is IgA, this is IgM, this is IgD, and this is IgE. And these are the characteristics or functions of all these antibody molecules here. So you are going to detect that antibody molecules in the ELISA, or you are going to detect that antigens in this enzyme linked immunosorbent assay, or by using this enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. So what are the sample can be used for the enzyme linked immunosorbent assay test or this ELISA test? So we can take serum, we can take cerebrospinal fluid, that is CSF, you can take sputum, you can take urine, you can take semen, you can take supernatant of culture, bacterial culture, or you can take stool sample. So all these can be used as a specimen. So, and with the help of this specimen, you can able to diagnose the particular disease by using this enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. Now, as the name suggests here, this technique, it is the enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. So which are the different types of enzymes used in this ELISA test? So there is a horseradish peroxidase enzyme. It is most commonly used enzyme in this enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. Then alkaline phosphatase, beta galactosidase, lactoperoxidase, then tetramethyl benzidine. So all these are the component, okay, or enzymes used here. This is the chemical here. And in case of this peroxidase enzyme, the substrate is the hydrogen peroxide. So this hydrogen peroxide get converted into water as well as oxygen in the presence of electron donors and in presence of this peroxidase enzyme. Okay, that is horseradish peroxidase enzyme. And Likewise, that diaminobenzidine or 4-chloronaphthol, which themselves get oxidized into the reaction. And oxidation of this diaminobenzidine produces dark brown color, whereas the 4-chloronaphthol, it produces purple color in this enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. So these enzyme, so what are the substrate then here? Because there are these are the different enzymes used in enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. Now, which are the substrate? For example, this alkaline phosphatase. This is the substrate for this enzyme. This is the chromogenic substrate, and the stopping or blocking reaction, that is 1 molar NaOH. Horseradish peroxidase. This is the substrate for this enzyme, and this is the chromogenic substance which get converted to colored compound later on. Then again, here also there is a H2O2 is there, and the chromogen substance is here phenylene diamine, and this 1 molar HCl, that is the blocking or stopping chemical. See, this is the suppose well, and how that reaction takes place here in the enzyme linked immunosorbent assay, which is nothing but the principle of this enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. So this is the substrate molecule. So see, this portion, it is nothing but the well. It is a well, for example, in which that different types of components are attached, for example. So this is the primary antibody here, and this primary antibody molecule, it get bind to the particular antigen, for example. Okay, now this secondary antibody molecule, these are specific to these antibodies, so they get bind to these antibody molecule, to which that enzyme get attached. And when you will add substrate, then that enzyme convert that substrate into the colored product. Okay, so this colored product, presence or occurrence of this colored product, that indicates there is a presence of that antigen or antibody in the sample. Okay, so that is nothing but the principle of the enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. See, these are the few steps in this ELISA. So which are the steps here? See, the basic steps here, the first one is here, you have to load the samples, unknown sample, in a triplicate into wells of the microplate strips. Okay, what you have to do in first step, you have to load the sample, whatever that, whether it is a CSF, whether it is a blood, whether it is a semen, whether it is or whatever that sample is here, that you have to add in the microtiter wells, and you have to incubate for 5 minutes. 5 minutes you have to incubate that. Then after that, in second step, what you have to do, you have to add the primary antibody molecule. Okay, see, this one, this blue color, these are the antigens or that whatever that components is present in the sample, and that you are going to detect. So this is the antigen, blue color, it is a antigen molecule. Where it is present? It is present in the specimen, which is collected from the patient, and it is added in the microtiter well. Okay, so it is added in microtiter well. Now after that, in this way, that reaction will take place here. You have to add primary antibody to the all wells, and you have to incubate for 5 minutes. After that, wash, then add enzyme linked secondary antibody molecule. See, this is the, this one pink color, and that Y shape structure, that is the enzyme linked secondary antibody molecule. So that will get bind or identify, and when that substrate is added, so at that time, that enzyme convert that substrate into the colored compound. Okay, so this is the, this blue color, it is an enzyme substrate complex. Okay, that is in the ELISA, and there is a formation of colored compound. So formation of this colored compound, that indicates that particular specimen which is collected from the patient, that consists of that particular antigen, or there is a, in his sample, there is a pathogen is present. So in this way, that ELISA test is used to diagnose the particular disease. Okay, so these are the types of ELISA. One is the indirect ELISA, second one is sandwich ELISA, third one is the competitive ELISA. So one by one we will see here. Direct ELISA, see, these are the virus samples on the surface. Then you will add antibody with enzyme conjugate attached to the viral antigen. So this is the Y-shaped structure, it is the antibody molecule, and there is a, this blue color, it is the enzyme molecule. So this, there is a specific reaction will take place here, antigen-antibody reaction, and these antibodies get adhere or get attached to the antigen molecule here, virus, that is a virus sample. And that substrate, when you will add substrate and enzyme, there is an interaction takes place, and then there is a colored compound is formed. So when this substrate is added to this complex, to this material here, so this enzyme convert this substrate into the colored compound. So substrate and enzyme interaction create the color change for the detection, and this change in the color, it indicates there is a presence of virus in the sample. Okay, so that is the one indirect ELISA. Second one is here, sandwich ELISA. So antigens, for example, tumor markers, hormones, as well as serum proteins, that can be determined or that can be tested by using this sandwich ELISA. And this antigen in the sample, it get bind to the captured antibody molecules on the microwell, and it get immobilized. That means it get adhered. And this antibody of the enzyme conjugate, then it get bind to the antigen present in the sample, which is in the sandwich of antigen antibody or antigen, that is antibody antigen or antibody enzyme complex, which is bound to the microwell in this way. So this is the solid support to which these green color antibodies are added. Then after that, antigens are added from the sample, for example. So they get specifically react to this antibody molecule. So when you will add antibody enzyme conjugate, so this is the antibody, this is the enzyme. So this complex, when it is added, so and after that, when substrate is added, so they get bind. So even after washing, these structures cannot be washed because they get attached to this antigen antibody complex here, primary antibody. And after washing, so whatever that free structures will be there, they get washed. But when substrate is added, which is a colorless, so this substrate get reacted with this enzyme molecule, and that enzyme convert that product substrate into the colored compound. So that indicates the, what this indicates here, formation of colored compound, that particular antigens are present in the patient sample or whatever that sample here. And third one is the, see, this is again antibody molecules, second antibody with enzyme here, then antibody antigen molecules, then after that enzyme produces, see, this is the complex will be there, that these are the primary antibodies, then antigens, this is the secondary antibody, this is the enzyme, and when substrate is added, so that will produces the colored compounds. Okay, and again formation of that colored compounds, that indicate that test is or ELISA test is positive. The next one is the competitive ELISA. As the name suggests here, there is a competition, and it is used to determine small molecular antigens, for example, T3, T4 or progesterone hormones. And in this ELISA, that antibody molecules are coated to the microwell, or they are present in the microwell. Then when serum antigen as well as labeled antigen added together, so there will be competition. Okay. And this antigen and antibody antigen or enzyme complex will bound to the inversely related to the concentration of antigen present in the sample, because there will one sample will be in more concentration, so there will be competition. Okay, and that bound enzyme, it get conjugated, that reacts with the chromogenic substrate, that is a colorless substrate, which is added to the that microtiter well, and there is a formation of color reaction. So that may be the blue or the yellow color, that indicates that ELISA, competitive ELISA test is positive. That means that particular sample, it consists of these antigens here, that may be T3, T4 or progesterone. So in this way, that competitive ELISA is conducted here. See, this is the diagram of three types of ELISA. One is indirect ELISA. It is used to detect the antibody molecules of HIV or hepatitis C virus. See, these are the antigen coated wells, then washed, add specific antibody to the antigen molecule. These are added, again wash, then add enzyme antibody complex here, secondary antibody, wash, then add substrate. So there will be colored compound will be formed here. So formation of colored compound, that indicates there is a presence of antibodies of HIV or HCV in that patient blood or serum. So that means that patient is suffering from or he get infected with HIV or he get infected with HCV. This is sandwich ELISA, antibody coated well, then add antigen to be measured, wash, add enzyme, again wash, colored compound. Same principle is here in all these here. But there is a competitive ELISA, so there is a competition between free testosterone and that antigen molecules here. So in this way, that tests are performed. See, this is the result here. Negative, because it is a colorless compound. This is control. For negative control, we can see here, then patient B, patient C, and patient A. Okay. So this is positive because that patient, there is a formation of colored compound, or here also there is a positive test is here. Okay, positive control, and this is negative control. for the comparison. Okay, so this patient, you can compare patient A and you can compare with this patient C or this one as a control. So this is the positive. So in this way that ELISA is performed. So what are the importance of incubation here? So to for the proper reaction here between that antigen and antibody molecule, because there is a bonds are present or there is a binding is there in between antigen and antibody molecule, that's why that incubation period is also required. And for washing, for the removal of any unbound antibody molecule or any unbound antigen molecule, so that there is a proper washing is required. So that's why extra antigen or extra antibody molecule can be removed. See, this is the ELISA plate where that microtiter wells are present. So these are microtiter wells, generally 96 wells are present. That means at a time you can check 96 samples, then mark on one side alphabetically, numerically on the other side, and they can comes along with that ELISA kit. That is called as ELISA kit here. So test performance using clean pipette, add 100 microliter of diluted serum sample or any sample to the or dilute the sera to the which is to be tested as 1:100 in the sample diluted to each well and incubate for 1 hour at 37 degrees Celsius. Then after that you have to perform that test like this here, as I have already told in previous slide. Okay, that is the same diagram here. See, this is the ELISA reader, measures the absorbance. So at that time you have to measure the absorbance at 450 nanometer by using spectrophotometer or by using colorimeter, and then you have to calculate the absorbance of each sample as a reference. So what are the advantages of ELISA? So reagents are relatively cheap and have a long shelf life. It is highly specific and sensitive. That means low concentration of that antigen or antibody can be detected. No radiation hazards occur during labeling. Easy perform and quick procedure. Then equipment can be inexpensive and widely available, and that ELISA can be used in for the diagnosis of different infections. So friends, you have to join. The next point is here, that is disadvantages of enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. So the measurement of enzyme activity, it can be more complex as compared to the measurement of activity of some type of the radioisotopes. That means it is easy to use radioisotopes as compared to enzyme. So, or the measurement of enzyme activity, it is difficult or it is complex. So this is one of the disadvantages of this enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. Then enzyme activity that may be affected by plasma components, so which are present in that plasma, so that can affect the activity of the enzyme. Then the kits, which are available in market, so that kits generally, so that kits, they are not cheap or they are costly, and they are very specific to the particular antigen. They won't recognize any other antigen because the specificity is very high. Okay, and false positives or negatives result can be possible, especially if there is a mutation in antigen takes place, or if that antigen altered, or if that antigen can change. So then there is a false positive or false negative results can be occur. Okay, so these are the some disadvantages of this enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. Now the limitations: the results may not be absolute, antibody must be available, then the concentration may be unclear, possibility of false positive result or possibility of false negative results. That were the limitations. So what are the applications of this enzyme linked immunosorbent assay? So this enzyme linked immunosorbent assay, this is useful for the detection of mycobacterium antibodies in case of tuberculosis. So there is a detection of rotaviruses in fecal matter or in stool sample, detection of hepatitis B markers in serum, detection of HIV antibodies in blood samples, and it also has found different applications in food industry, in the detection of potential eggs, food allergens, that may be milk, peanuts, walnuts or almonds. So these are the some applications. So another applications in that can be useful for the detection of hormones, then in vaccine quality control, in proteins, genetically modified organisms, infectious agent or viral, bacterial, parasitic, fungal, drug markers, then tumor markers, serum proteins, then these antibodies can be detected here. Then these ELISA can be useful for the newborn screening, or it is useful in clinical research for the diagnosis. So that is about the enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. So this is the sensitivity of various immunoassays. See, if you see the ELISA, enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, so it can detect less than 0.0001 to 0.01 microgram of antibody molecule per ml. So it is very, or it is highly sensitive. Okay. So these are the another reactions or that immunoassays, precipitation, fluids, precipitation in gels, then Mancini radial immunodiffusion. So these are the different reactions here. Okay. Or that sensitivity of these different types of immunoassays. So here we have finished the so this is the equipments for performing of this enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. So these are the micropipettes here. Okay. And these are the microtiter wells. So at a single time, you can fill the samples in so many wells here by using this pipette. Okay. So this is the ELISA reader. This is for incubation like that. This is the ELISA reader here. Okay. So this is about the, and this is the whole equipment we can say here, including that antigens, antibodies, buffers, substrate, like that. Yeah, microtiter wells. So all these are there. Okay. See here, this is a, that wells or that microtiter well is put here. Okay. Here buffer solution or that samples like this. So here we completed about the enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. Now the next one is the radioimmunoassay. Okay. Or in short, it is called as RIA. So this radioimmunoassay or RIA, it is a very sensitive in vitro assay technique. In vitro, that is nothing but in the laboratory, because when that particular reaction or process or mechanism, it is out, it is going on in the animal body, including all animals, including humans also, then it is called as in vivo. But if that particular reaction, it is taking place outside the body, then it is called as in vitro. Just take the example of in vitro fertilization. So when that fertilization, it is taking place in the fallopian tube, for example, then it is an in vivo process. But if that fertilization is taking place in test tube, in case of test tube baby, so then it is called as the in vitro fertilization. Okay. So in vitro in the main, in the sense, that means outside the body or in the laboratory or in the glassware. Okay. So this radioimmunoassay, it is one type of the highly sensitive in vitro assay technique, and it is used to measure the concentrations of antigens, that may be hormone levels in the blood, or with the help of these antibody molecule. So this radioimmunoassay test, or which is called as the radioallergosorbent test, it is an example of this radioimmunoassay or RIA, and it is used to detect the causative allergen for the allergy. So the causative agent of that, that is called as the allergens, which is responsible for that particular allergy. And that allergen can be find out, can be detected with the help of these radioallergosorbent test, which is one type of the radioimmunoassay. And to perform this radioimmunoassay, the known quantity or known concentration of that antigen molecule, it is made radioactive. So there is it is radio labeled, so it become radioactive, and that frequently by labeling it with the gamma radioactive isotopes of this iodine, which get attached to the tyrosine molecule. Tyrosine, it is a one amino acid here. So this, to perform that radioimmunoassay, so as I told here, that antigen make radioactive or frequently labeled with the gamma radioactive isotopes of iodine molecule, which are attached to tyrosine. Then this radio labeled antigen, now it is mixed with the known quantity of the antibody molecule, which is specific to that radio label antigen. And as a result, the two, that is antigen and antibody, they specifically bind with each other because they are specific in nature. After that, the sample of serum from the patient, which consists of unknown quantity of the same antigen, is added. We don't know the quantity, we don't know the concentration of that antigen present in the patient's serum. So we have to find out that. Okay. Then that sample is added, or that patient sample is added here. and this causes the unlabeled or which is the cold antigens from the serum to compete with the radiolabeled antigens, which are called as hot antigens. For which there is a competition is there, that is for the binding to the antibody molecules or binding to the antibody sites. So as the concentration of cold antigen increases, cold antigens means here antigens which are present in the serum of that patient increases, then more of these antigen molecules they get bind to the antibody. So there is a displacing of the radiolabeled antigens. So radiolabeled antigens cannot bind there because these antigens are more in number. Okay, and reducing the ratio of antigen bound radiolabeled antigen molecule to the free radiolabeled antigen. So that ratio will be decreased here. So instead of binding that radiolabeled antigen, that antigen from the patient serum will bind to the antibody molecule. And so that ratio of radiolabeled antigen and antibody will be decreases, and that separated from the unbound ones. And finally, the radioactivity of the free antigen, which is remaining in the supernatant, that is measured by using the gamma counter. So that will detect the antigen molecules here. So this is the principle of this radioimmunoassay. Okay. So use an immune reaction, that is antigen antibody reaction, to estimate the ligand. Estimate means to find out the quantity. So this is the antigen molecule plus this is another antigen molecule which is radiolabeled. What that star indicates here, flower like, that is the antigen is radiolabeled. Okay. Plus there is an antibody molecule. So there is a reaction takes place between these antigen antibody molecules, and again there is a these antigen antibody molecules are also there. So this antibody molecule get bind to the antigen molecule which is not radiolabeled, and this antibody molecule get bind to the antigen molecule which is radiolabeled. Again here some antigens are free and some antibodies are also free here. So this unbound antigen and antigen that is radiolabeled and radio which is not radiolabeled, they get washed out, and that radioactivity of that bound residue will be measured, and that ligand concentration, it is inversely related to the radioactivity. That means if the radioactivity is more, that means the concentration of that ligand is less. So what is that ligand means here? It is nothing but the antigen molecule. Okay, and this antigen star, it is a radiolabeled antigen or it is a radiolabeled ligand. Okay, so is tarah se, so in this way that quantity or concentration can be measured. Now the next one is here, advantages and disadvantages of radioimmunoassay. So what are the advantages and disadvantages here? So disadvantages that this radioimmunoassay, it is highly specific in nature, that is immune reactions are specific. Then these are highly sensitive, that means that immune reactions are very sensitive. Then what are the disadvantages? So radiation hazards will be there, because radiations, if that persons or technicians get exposed to the radiations, then there is a possibility of occurrence of cancers here. Okay, because of using of this radiolabeled reagents. Then that's why that skilled persons will be required, or it requires the specially trained persons. Then lab requires special license to handle the radioactive material, and it requires the special arrangements for requisition, storage of radioactive material, and after that, if there is a disposal of the waste radioactive material. Otherwise, if you will throw that radioactive material in particular area or surrounding area, so that will cause the hazard to the population living in that particular area. So these are the disadvantages of that radioimmunoassay. Okay. Now the next one, requirements of radioimmunoassay. What you will require? So there is a preparation and characterization of the antigen, that is ligand to be analyzed, then radio labeling of the antigen molecule, preparation of the specific antibody molecule, and development of the assay system. Then, so how there is a preparation and radio labeling of antigen? So that antigens are prepared by synthesis of the molecule, or that can be isolated from the natural sources. That may be viruses, that may be bacteria, or any other. After that, there is a radio labeling is there. That means that radiolabeled molecules H3AC14 or this iodine-125, these are used as a radioactive tags, and these antigens are or that tags are bound to this antigen molecule. So that is called as the radiolabeling. So the tagging should not affect any antigenic specificity and antigenic activity. Okay. So then preparation of the specific antibody. So antigen injected intradermally into the rabbits. or in guinea pigs. So in response to this antigen molecule, these rabbits as well as guinea pigs, they produces the antibody in their bodies. Okay. So, and these antibodies which are produced in guinea pigs or in rabbits, these are specific to this antigen which is injected. Then after that, the antibodies are recovered or purified from the serum of these rabbits or from the serum of these guinea pigs. And there are some ligands, these are not antigenic in nature. That means they does not induce any antibody production. And that examples include hormones, steroids, drugs. These are called as haptens. Again, gastrin, morphine. And these haptens, when they get conjugated to albumin, individually this albumin, it is not antigenic in nature, or that haptens are not antigenic in nature. But when there is a conjugation is there in between these haptens and that albumin, then this haptan albumin complex or conjugate, it become antigenic in nature. That means it induces the antibody production, okay, or it induces immune response. So what is the development of the assay system? So it is a very important step in the that is the separation of unbound antigens, and that can be done by binding these antibodies to the microtiter well surface having the solid phase ready immunoassay. Then that antigen, they get bound to the fixed antibodies which get remain stuck to the inner surface of the microtiter well. And after decanting, that is removing excess antigens or antibodies, or washing the well, that will remove the unbound antigens. And other techniques for separation, that is called as the centrifugation here. Then what is the procedure for assay? So add known amounts of the test sample, plus you have to add a labeled antigen into the microtiter well. Then after that, incubate and allow the reaction to reach completion. Then after reaction completion, you have to decant or you have to wash contents of the microtiter well and remove all the unbound antigens. So automatically after washing, that unbound antibody antigens will be removed. Then radioactivity remaining in the microtiter wells, it is measured by the Giger-Müller counter, or it is called as GM counter or Giger-Müller counter. That is the instrument or the counter which is used to measure the radioactivity of the substance, or there is a scintillation counting is also there. Then intensity of that radioactivity, it is inversely proportional or correlated with the concentration of antigen in the test sample. So what is the meaning of this here? So if the concentration of that antigens in the test sample is very high, then the radioactivity will be less, because that radio-labeled antigens can be displaced by this large number of that antigens here. So that's why radioactivity will decreases. And the sensitivity, these are sensitive to very low concentration of antigens. So these are the antibodies, types of labeling: radioisotopes, enzymes, then fluorescent antibodies, chemiluminescent probes, and metal tags are also there. What are the radioimmunoassay advantages here? Flexibility, sensitive, and size. Disadvantages: toxicity because of that radioactive labels, shelf life, and disposable cost because there is a radioactive waste material is there. So what these are the advantages again. It is widely used because of its great sensitivity. Using antibodies of high affinity, it is possible to detect a few picograms, that is 10^-12 gram of hormone in the tube. So picogram, it is a very, very small quantity. And this small quantity can be detected by using this radioimmunoassay. That's why it had a great sensitivity, or it is highly sensitive. The greater the specificity of the anti-serum, the greater the specificity of this radioimmunoassay. Limitations: the main drawbacks to this radioimmunoassay, that is nothing but the expense and hazards of the preparing and handling of radioactive antigen. Because that radioactive substances, these are hazardous to the human body. And both iodine-125 or iodine-131, they imitate these gamma radiations. And that requires a special counting equipment. So that is costly. Then the body concentrates iodine atoms, radioactive or not, in the thyroid gland, where they are incorporated in this thyroxine hormone, that is in T4 hormone. So that are the limitations here. See, this is the radioactive antigen. This is the first antibody molecule. Then you have to add unlabeled antigen. Unlabeled means that is coming from the patient serum. Okay. So that radioactive antigen, this orange color, it get displaced by this unlabeled antigen molecule. See this one. So there is a displacement of this. There is a competition is there, and precipitate this complex will be there, antigen antibody complex with anti immunoglobulin, or that is the second antibody molecule. So radioactivity of precipitate bound antigen can be measured, and that determines the concentration here. So this is the instrumentation of this radio immuno assay. So these radiations will hit silver grains. So this is the auto, that instrument or that technique is, that technique it is called as auto radiography. Okay, it is known as auto radiography, and here that radiation will hit the silver grains in the emulsion and expose them. So expose to the film or emulsion, then these isotopes, that means radioactive substances, they will emit the radiations, usually beta radiations, and that incubate that tissue with the radioactive ligand. So that can be detected here, radioactivity. And that auto radiography, that is the technique which is used to detect the radiography, radioactivity in this radio immuno assay. Okay. Then see, this is the instrumentation again, cathode rays, that is the radiation emitters here. Cathode rays, gamma radiations here, input window, resistor, counter. This is the instrument inside portion here, and this is the counter. See, okay. So here we have finished these two techniques here, that is enzyme linked immunosorbent assay and